Come all you fair and tender girls that flourish in your prime. Beware, beware, keep your garden fair. Let no man steal your time. Let no man steal your time. For when your time it is past and gone, you'll care no more for you. And every place where your time was waste will all spread away through. We'll all spread away through. The gardener's son was standing by.
Three flowers he gave to me, the pink, the blue, and the violet true, and the red, red rosy tree, and the red, red rosy tree. But I refused the red rose bush and gained the willow tree, that all the world may plainly see how my love slighted me, how my love slighted me.
Poems from Self-Portrait in a Convex Mirror by John Ashbery. As one put drunk into the packet boat. I tried each thing, only some were immortal and free. Elsewhere, we are as sitting in a place where sunlight filters down a little at a time, waiting for someone to come. Harsh words are spoken as the sun yellows the green of the maple tree. So this was all, but obscurely. I felt the stirrings of new breath in the pages, which all winter long had smelled like an old catalog. New sentences were starting up, but the summer was well along, not yet past the midpoint, but full and dark with the promise of that fullness, that time when one can no longer wander away, and even the least attentive fall silent to watch the thing that is prepared to happen. A look of glass stops you and you walk unshaken. Was I the perceived? Did they notice me this time as I am? Or is it postponed again? The children still at their games, clouds that arise with a swift impatience in the afternoon sky, then dissipate as limpid, dense twilight comes. Only in that tooting of a horn down there for a moment, I thought, the great formal affair was beginning, orchestrated, its colors concentrated in a glance, a ballade that takes in the whole world now, but lightly, still lightly, with wide authority and tact. The prevalence of those gray flakes falling? They are sun motes. You have slept in the sun longer than the Sphinx and are none the wiser for it. Come in, and I thought a shadow fell across the door. But it was only her come to ask once more if I was coming in and not to hurry in case I wasn't. The night sheen takes over. A moon of Cistercian pallor has climbed to the center of heaven, installed, finally involved with the business of darkness, and a sigh heaves from all the small things on earth, the books, the papers, the old garters, and union suit buttons. The summer demands and takes away too much. But night, the reserved, the reticent, gives more than it takes. as you came from the Holy Land. Of Western New York State, were the graves all right in their bushings? Was there a note of panic in the late August air because the old man had peed in his pants again? Was there turning away from late afternoon glare as though it too could be wished away? Was any of this present, and how could this be the magic solution to what you are in now? Whatever has held you motionless like this so long through the dark season, until now the women come out in navy blue and the worms come out of the compost to die. It is the end of any season. You reading there so accurately, sitting, not wanting to be disturbed as you came from that holy land, what other signs of Earth's dependency were upon you? What fixed sign at the crossroads? What lethargy in the avenues where all is said in a whisper? What tone of voice among the hedges? What tone and will befall not before the census and the writing down of names? Remember, you are free to wander away as from other times, other scenes that were taking place, the history of someone who came too late. The time is ripe now, and the adage is hatching as the seasons change and tremble. It is finally, though that thing of monstrous interest were happening in the sky, but the sun is setting and prevents you from shaken again. Put down in weak rage, knowing as the brain does, it can never come about. Not here, not yesterday in the past, only in the gap of today, filling itself as emptiness is disturbed, is distributed in the idea of what time it is, when that time is already past. Farm. A protracted wait that is also night. Funny how the white fence posts go on and on, a quiet reproach that goes under as day ends, though the geometry remains, a thing like nudity at the end of a long stretch. It makes such a difference. Okay, so is the really not the same thing at all, viewed through the wrong end of a telescope and holding up that bar. Living with the girl got kicked into the sod of things. There was a to-do end of June. Comings and goings before the matter is dropped, but it stays around like her faint point or frown or the dripping leaves of pie plant and hollyhock, also momentary in defeat. No one has the last laugh. Farm 2. I was thinking, now that the flowers are forgotten, a whole new frontier, backing around the old one, are swamping its former good ideas, plowing under the errors too, in its tin maelstrom. The overloaded ferryboat slowly moves away from the dock. Are these dog-eared things? Weeds, what you call them, these things sitting like mail to be read toward the end of afternoon, things the mailmen brought. I would like to enroll in the new course at the study center. A latticework crust, holes or blobs of darkness, has been placed across the road. You can't walk out too far that way anymore. They say the children are demolishing the insides of the woods, burnt orange, that it's spectacular. But it doesn't take us out into the open sea, only to the middle of a river, fumbling which way to go. Fear of death. What is it now with me, and is it as I have become? Is there no state free from the boundary lines of before and after? The window is open today, and the air pours in with piano notes in its skirts, as though to say, "Look, John, I've brought these and these," that is, a few Beethovens, some Brahmses, and few choice Poulenc notes. Yes, it is being free again. The air, it has to keep coming back, because that's all it's good for. I want to stay with it out of fear. That keeps me from walking up certain steps, knocking at certain doors, fear of growing old, alone, and of finding no one at the evening end of the path except another myself. Nodding a curt greeting. Well, you've been a while, but now we're back together, which is what counts. Air in my path, you could shorten this, but the breeze has dropped, and silence is the last word. Ode to Bill. Some things we do take up a lot more time and are considered a fruitful, natural thing to do. I am coming out of one way to behave into a plowed cornfield. On my left, goals. On an inland vacation, they seem to mind the way I write. Or, to take another example, last month I vowed to write more. What is writing? Well, in my case, it's getting down on paper, not thoughts exactly, but ideas, maybe. Ideas about thoughts. Thoughts is too grand a word. Ideas is better, though not precisely what I mean. Someday I'll explain. Not today, though. I feel as though someone had made me a vest which I was wearing out of doors into the countryside out of loyalty to the person, although there is no one to see except me. With my inner vision of what I look like, the wearing is both a duty and a pleasure because it absorbs me too much. One horse stands out irregularly against the land over there, and am I receiving this vision? Is it mine, or do I already owe it for other visions unnoticed and unrecorded? On the great relaxed curve of time, all the forgotten springs, dropped pebbles, songs once heard that then passed out of light into everyday oblivion? He moves away slowly, looks up and pumps the sky, a lingering question. Him too we can sacrifice to the end progress, for we must be moving on. Sandpail. Process of a red stripe through much whiplash of environmental sweepstakes misinterprets slabs as they come forward. A footprint directs traffic in the center of flat crocus plaza as the storm incurves on this new situation. Why are there developments? A transparent shovel paves, they say, residual elastic fetters, pictures of moments brought under the sand. Märchenbilder. Es war einmal. No, it's too heavy to be said. Besides, you aren't paying attention anymore. How shall I put it? The rain thundered on the uneven red flagstones. The steadfast tin soldier gazed beyond the drops, remembering the hat-shaped paper boat that soon... That's not it either. Think about the long summer evenings of the past, the Queen Anne's lace. Sometimes a musical phrase would perfectly sum up the mood of a moment. One of those lovelorn sonatas for wind instruments was riding past on a solemn white horse. Everybody wondered who the new arrival was. Pomp of flowers, decorations junked next day. Now look out of the window. The sky is clear and bland. The wrong kind of day for business or games or betting on a sure thing. The trees weep drops into the water at night. Slowly couples gather. She looks into his eyes. It would not be good to be left alone. He, I'll stay as long as the night allows. This was one of those night rainbows in negative color. As we advance, it retreats. We see we are now far into a cave. Must be. Yet there seem to be trees all around, and a wind lifts their leaves slightly. I want to go back, out of the bad stories. But there's always the possibility of that next one. No, it's another almond tree or a ring-swallowed frog. Yet they are beautiful as we people them with ourselves. They are empty as cupboards, to spend whole days drenched in them, waiting for the next whisper, for the word in the next room. This is how the princes must have behaved, lying down in the frugality of sleep. Robin Hood's barn. This would be the day a few small drops of rain, a dab of this, a touch of eau de cologne air, as long as it's suggestive and it mounts a serenade to the surrounding love. You bad birds, But God shall not punish you. You shall be with us in heaven, though less conscious of your happiness, perhaps, than we. Hell is not quite satisfactory heaven, probably, but you are the fruit and jewels of all is over in a few years. 26, 27. Who were those people who came down to the boat and met us that time? And your young years become a kind of clay, out of which the older, more rounded, and also brusquer retort is fashioned. The greeting that takes you into the night with, like a lantern up ahead. The where were yous, meanwhile, the dark is waiting like so many other things. Dumbness and voluptuousness among them. It is good to be part of it, in the dream that is the kernel deep in it, the unpretentious, unblushing, but also the steep side stretching far away. For this we pay, for this tonight and every night, but for the time being we are free. And meanwhile, the songs protect us in a way and the special climate. Self-portrait in a convex mirror. As Parmigianino did it, the right hand, bigger than the head, thrust at the viewer and swerving easily as though to protect what it advertises. A few leaded panes, old beams, fur, pleated muslin, a coral ring run together in a movement supporting the face, which swims toward and away like the hand, except that it is in repose. It is what is sequestered. Vasari says, Francesco one day set himself to take his own portrait, looking at himself for that purpose in a convex mirror, such as is used by barbers. He accordingly caused a ball of wood to be made by a turner, and having divided it in half, brought it to the size of a mirror, he set himself with great art to copy all that he saw in the glass. Chiefly his reflection, of which the portrait is the reflection once removed. The glass chose to reflect only what he saw, which was enough for his purpose. His image glazed, embalmed, projected at a one. The soul establishes itself. But how far can it swim out through the eyes and still return safely to its nest? The surface of the mirror being convex, the distance increases significantly. That is, enough to make the point that the soul is a captive, treated humanely, kept in suspension, unable to advance much farther than your look as it interprets this picture. Pope Clement and his court were stupefied by it, according to Vasari, and promised a commission that never materialized. The soul has to stay where it is, even though restless, hearing raindrops at the pane, the sighing of autumn leaves thrashed by the wind, longing to be free outside. But it must stay, posing in this place. It must move as little as possible. This is what the portrait says, but there is in that gaze a combination of tenderness, amusement, and regret so powerful in its restraint that one cannot look for long. The secret is too plain. The pity of it smarts, makes hot tears spurt, that the soul is not a soul, has no secret, is small, and it fits its hollow perfectly. Its room, our moment of attention. That is the tune, but there are no words. The words are only speculation. From the Latin speculum, mirror. They seek and cannot find the meaning of the music. We see only postures of the dream, riders of the motion that swings the face into view under evening skies, with no false disarray as proof of authenticity. But it is life and globed. One would like to stick one's hand out of the globe, but its dimension, what carries it, will not allow it. No doubt it is this, not the reflex to hide something, which makes the hand loom large as it retreats slightly. There is no way to build it flat like a section of a wall. It must join the segment of a circle, roving back to the body of which it seems so unlikely a part, to fence in and shore up the face, on which the effort of this condition reads like a pinpoint of a smile, a spark or star one is not sure of having seen, as darkness resumes. A perverse light whose imperative of subtlety dooms in advance its conceit to light up. Unimportant, but meant, Francesco, your hand is big enough to wreck the sphere, and too big, one would think, to weave delicate meshes that only argue its further detention. big but not coarse, merely on another scale, like a dozing whale on the sea bottom in relation to the tiny, self-important ship on the surface. But your eyes proclaim that everything is surface. The surface is what's there, and nothing can exist except what's there. There are no recesses in the room, only alcoves. And the window doesn't matter much, or that sliver of window or mirror on the right, even as a gauge of the weather, which is the French, which in French is le temps, the word for time, and which follows a course wherein changes are merely features of the whole. The whole is stable within instability, a globe like ours, resting on a pedestal of vacuum, a ping pong ball secure on its jet of water. And just as there are no words for the surface that is, no words to say what really is, that is not superficial, but a visible core, then there is no way out of the problem of pathos versus experience. You will stay on, restive, serene in your gesture, which is neither embrace nor warning, but which holds something of both in pure affirmation that doesn't affirm anything. The balloon pops, the attention turns dully away, clouds in the puddle stir up into sawtoothed fragments. I think of the friends who came to see me, of what yesterday was like, a peculiar slant of memory that intrudes on the dreaming model in the silence of the studio as he considers lifting the pencil to the self-portrait. How many people came and stayed a certain time, uttered light or dark speech that became part of you, like light behind the wind-blown fog and sand, filtered and influenced by it, until no part remains that is surely you. Those voices in the dusk have told you all, and still the tale goes on in the form of memories deposited in irregular clumps of crystals, whose curved hand controls, Francesco, the turning seasons and the thoughts that peel off and fly away at breathless speeds, like the last stubborn leaves ripped from wet branches. I see in this only the chaos of your round mirror, which organizes everything around the pole star of your eyes, which are empty, know nothing, dream but reveal nothing. I feel the carousel starting slowly and going faster and faster, desk, papers, books, photographs of friends, the window and the trees merging into one neutral band that surrounds me on all sides, everywhere I look. And I cannot explain the action of leveling, why it should all boil down to one uniform substance, a magma of interiors. My guide in these matters is yourself, firm, oblique, accepting everything with the same wraith of a smile. And as time speeds up so that it is soon much later, I can know only the straight way out, the distance between us. Long ago, the strewn evidence meant something, the small accidents and pleasures of the day as it moved gracelessly on, a housewife doing chores. Impossible now to restore those properties of the silver blur that is the record of what you accomplished by sitting down, with great art to copy all that you saw in the glass, so as to perfect and rule out the extraneous forever. In the circle of your intentions, certain spars remain that perpetuate the enchantment of self with self. I-beams, muslin, coral. It doesn't matter, because these are all things as they are today, before one's shadow ever grew out of the field into the thoughts of tomorrow. Tomorrow is easy, but today is uncharted, desolate, reluctant as any landscape to yield what are laws of perspective. After all, only to the painter's deep mistrust, a weak instrument, though necessary. Of course, some things are possible, it knows, but it doesn't know which ones. Someday we will try to do as many things as possible, and perhaps we shall succeed at a handful of them. But this will not have anything to do with what is promised today, our landscape sweeping out from us to disappear on the horizon. Today, enough of a cover burnishes to keep the supposition of promises together in one piece of surface, letting one ramble back home from them so that these even stronger possibilities can remain whole without being tested. Actually, the skin of the bubble chamber is as tough as reptile eggs. Everything gets programmed. There, in due course, more keeps getting included without adding to the sum. And just as one gets accustomed to a noise that kept one awake but now no longer does, So the room contains this flow like an hourglass, without varying in climate or quality, except perhaps to brighten bleakly and almost invisibly into focus, sharpening toward death, more of this later. What should be the vacuum of a dream becomes continually replete as the source of dreams is being tapped, so that this one dream may wax, flourish like a cabbage rose, defying sumptuary laws, leaving us to awake and try to begin living in what has now become a slum. Sidney Freeberg, in his Parmigianino, says of it, "Realism in this portrait no longer produces an objective truth, but a bizarria. However, its distortion does not create a feeling of disharmony. The forms retain a strong measure of ideal beauty." Because, fed by our dreams, so inconsequential until one day we notice the hole they left, now their importance, if not their meaning, is plain. They were to nourish a dream which includes them all, as they are, finally reversed in the accumulating mirror. They seemed strange because we couldn't actually see them, and we realized this only at a point. The forms retain a strong measure of ideal beauty as they forage in its secret on our idea of distortion. Why be unhappy with this arrangement, since dreams prolong us as they are aborted, absorbed? Something like living occurs, a movement out of the dream into its codification. As I start to forget it, it presents its stereotype again. But it is an unfamiliar stereotype, the face riding at anchor, issued from hazards soon to accost others. Rather angel than man, Vasari. Perhaps an angel looks like everything we have forgotten. I mean, forgotten things that don't seem familiar when we meet them again, lost beyond telling, which were ours once. This would be the point of invading the privacy of this man who dabbled in alchemy, but whose wish here was not to examine. He wished through them to impart the sense of novelty and amazement to the spectator, Friedberg. Later portraits such as the Uffizi gentleman and the Borghese young prelate and the Naples Antia issue from mannerist tensions. But here, as Friedberg points out, the surprise, the tension are in the concept rather than its realization. The consonance of the High Renaissance is present, though distorted by the mirror. What is novel is the extreme care in rendering the velleities of the rounded and reflecting surface. It is the first mirror portrait, so that you could be fooled for a moment before you realize the reflection isn't yours. You feel then like one of those Hoffman characters who have been deprived of a reflection, except that the whole of me is seen to be supplanted by the strict otherness of the painter in his other room. We have surprised him at work, but no, he has surprised us as he works. The picture is almost finished, the surprise almost over, as when one looks out, startled by a snowfall, which even now is ending in specks and sparkles of snow. It happened while you were inside asleep, and there is no reason why you should have been awake for it, except that the day is ending and it will be hard for you to get to sleep tonight, at least until late. The shadow of the city injects its own urgency. Rome, where Francesco was at work during the sack. His inventions amazed the soldiers who burst in on him. They decided to spare his life, but he left soon after. Vienna, where the painting is today, where I saw it with Pierre in the summer of 1959. New York, where I am now, which is a logarithm of other cities. Our landscape is alive with filiations, shuttlings. Business is carried on by look, gesture, hearsay. It is another life to the city, the backing of the looking glass of the unidentified but precisely sketched studio. It wants to siphon off the life of the studio, deflate its mapped space to enactments, island it. The operation has been temporarily stalled, but something new is on the way, a new preciosity in the wind. Can you stand it, Francesco? Are you strong enough for it? The wind brings what it knows not. It is self-propelled, blind, has no notion of itself. It is inertia that, once acknowledged, saps all activity, secret or public. Whispers of the word that can't be understood, but can be felt, a chill, a blight, moving outward along the capes and peninsulas of your nerves, and so to the archipelagos and to the bathed, aired secrecy of the open sea. This is its negative side. Its positive side is making you notice life and the stresses that only seem to go away, but now as this new mode questions are seen to be hastening out of style. If they are to become classics, they must decide which side they are on. Their reticence has undermined the urban scenery, made its ambiguities look willful, the games of an old man. What we need now is this unlikely challenger pounding on the gates of an amazed castle. Your argument, Francesco, had begun to grow stale as no answers were forthcoming. If it dissolves now into dust, that only means its time had come some time ago. But look now and listen. It may be that another life is stocked there in recesses no one knew, that no one knew of, that it, not we, are the change, that we are in fact it. If we could get back to it, relive some of the way it looked, turn our faces to the globe as it sets and still be coming out all right. Nerves normal, breath normal. Since it is a metaphor made to include us, we are part of it and can live in it. In fact, we have done. Only leaving our minds bare for questioning, we now see we will not take place at random, but in an orderly way that means to menace nobody. The normal way things are done, like the concentric growing up of days around a life, correctly, if you think about it. A breeze like the turning of a page brings back your face. The moment takes such a big bite out of the haze of pleasant intuition it comes after. The locking into place is death itself. As Berg said of a phrase in Mahler's Ninth, or to quote Imogen in Cymbeline, there cannot be a pinch in death more sharp than this. For, though only exercise or tactic, it carries the momentum of a conviction that had been building. Mere forgetfulness cannot remove it, nor wishing it back as long as it remains the white precipitate of its dream in the climate of sighs flung across our world, a cloth over a birdcage. But it is certain that what is beautiful seems so only in relation to a specific life experienced or not, channeled into some form, steeped into the nostalgia of a collective past. The light sinks today with an enthusiasm I have known elsewhere and known why it seemed meaningful, that others felt this way years ago. I go on consulting this mirror that is no longer mine, for as much brisk vacancy as is to be my portion this time, and the vase is always full, because there is only just so much room and it accommodates everything. The sample one sees is not to be taken as merely that, but everything as it may be imagined outside time, not as a gesture, but as all, in the refined, assimilable state. But what is this universe the porch of as it veers in and out, back and forth, Love once tipped the scales, but now is shadowed, invisible, though mysteriously present around somewhere, but we know it cannot be sandwiched between two adjacent moments, that its windings lead nowhere to further tributaries, and that these empty themselves into a vague sense of something that can never be known, even though it seems likely that each of us knows what it is and is capable of communicating it to the other. But the look somewhere as a sign makes one want to push forward, ignoring the apparent naivete of the attempt, not caring that no one is listening, since the light has been lit once and for all in the eyes and is present, unimpaired, a permanent anomaly, awake and silent. On the surface of it, there seems no special reason why that light should be focused by love, or why the city, falling with its beautiful suburbs into space always less clear, less defined, should read as a support of its progress. The easel upon which the drama unfolded to its own satisfaction and to the end of our dreaming, as we had never imagined it would end, in worn daylight with the painted promise showing through as a gauge, a bond. This nondescript, never to be defined daytime is the secret of where it takes place, and we can no longer return to the various conflicting statements gathered, lapses of memory of the principal witnesses. All we know is that we are a little early, that today has that special lapidary todayness that the sunlight reproduces faithfully in casting twig shadows on blithe sidewalks. No previous day would have been like this. I used to think they were all alike, that the present always looked the same to everybody. But this confusion drains away as one is always cresting into one's present. Yet the poetic, straw-colored space of the long corridor that leads back into the painting, its darkening opposite, is this some figment of art not to be imagined as real, let alone special? Hasn't it gone to its lair in the present we are always escaping from and falling back into as the water wheel of days pursues its uneventful, even serene course? I think it is trying to say it is today, and we must get out of it even as the public is pushing through the museum now so as to be out by closing time. You can't live there. The gray glaze of the past attacks all know-how. Secrets of wash and finish. No one alludes to the change. To do so might involve calling attention to oneself, which would augment the dread of not getting out before having seen the whole collection. Except for the sculptures in the basement, they are where they belong. Our time gets to be veiled, compromised, but the portraits will to endure. It hints at our own, which we were hoping to keep hidden. We don't need paintings or doggerel written by mature poets when the explosion is so precise, so fine. Is there any point even in acknowledging the existence of all that? Does it exist? Certainly the leisure to indulge stately pastimes doesn't anymore. Today has no margins. The event arrives flush with its edges, is of the same substance, indistinguishable. Play is something else. It exists in a society specifically organized as a demonstration of itself. There is no other way, and those assholes who would confuse everything with their mirror games, which seem to multiply stakes and possibilities, or at least confuse issues by means of an investing aura that would corrode the architecture of the whole in a haze of suppressed mockery, are beside the point. They are out of the game. Which doesn't exist until they are out of it. It seems like a very hostile universe, but as the principle of each individual thing is hostile too, exists at the expense of all others. As philosophers have often pointed out, at least this thing, the mute, undivided present, has the justification of logic, which in this instance isn't a bad thing. To caricature itself, this always happens, as in the game where a whispered phrase passed around the room ends up as something completely different. It is the principle that makes the work of art so unlike what the artist intended. Often he finds he has omitted the thing he started out to say in the first place. Seduced by flowers, explicit pleasures, he blames himself, though secretly satisfied with the result. Imagining he had a say in the matter and exercised an option of which he was hardly conscious, unaware that necessity circumvents such resolutions so as to create something new for itself, that there is no other way, that the history of creation proceeds according to stringent laws, and that things do get done in this way, but never the things we set out to accomplish and wanted so desperately to see come into being. Parmigianino must have realized this as he worked on his life-obstructing task. One is forced to read the perfectly plausible accomplishment of a purpose. Is there anything to be serious about beyond this otherness that gets included in the most ordinary forms of daily activity, changing everything slightly and profoundly, the tearing the matter of creation? Any creation, not just artistic creation, out of our hands to install it on some monstrous near peak, too close to ignore, too far for one to intervene? This otherness, this not being us, is all there is to look at in the mirror, though no one can say how it came to be this way. A ship flying unknown colors has entered the harbor. You are allowing the extraneous matters to break up your day, cloud the focus of the crystal ball. Its scene drifts away, like vapor scattered on the wind. The fertile thought associations that, until now, came so easily, appear no more or rarely. Their colorings are less intense, washed out by autumn rains and winds, spoiled, muddied, given back to you because they are worthless. Yet we are such creatures of habit that their implications are still around en permanence, confusing issues. To be serious only about sex is perhaps one way, but the sands are hissing as they approach the beginning of the big slide into what happened. This past is now here, the painter's reflected face in which we linger, receiving dreams and inspirations on an unassigned frequency. But the hues have turned metallic. The curves and edges are not so rich. Each person has one big theory to explain the universe, but it doesn't tell the whole story. And in the end, it is what an outside him that matters to him, and especially to us who have been given no help whatever in decoding our own man-sized quotient and must rely on secondhand knowledge. Yet I know that no one else's taste is going to be any help and might as well be ignored. Once it seems so perfect, gloss on the fine freckled skin, lips moistened as though about to part, releasing speech, and the familiar look of clothes and furniture that one forgets. This could have been our paradise, exotic, refuge within an exhausted world, but that wasn't in the cards because it couldn't have been the point. Aping naturalness may be the first step toward achieving an inner calm, but it is the first step only and often remains a frozen gesture of welcome etched on the air materializing behind it, a convention. And we have really no time for these except to use them for kindling. The sooner they are burnt up, the better for the roles we have to play. Therefore, I beseech you, withdraw that hand. Offer it no longer as a shield or greeting, the shield of a greeting, Francesco. There is room for one bullet in the chamber. Our looking through the wrong end of the telescope as you fall back at a speed faster than that of light to flatten ultimately among the features of the room, an invitation never mailed, the "it was all a dream" syndrome, though the "all" tells tersely enough how it wasn't. Its existence was real, though troubled, and the ache of this waking dream can never drown out the diagram still sketched on the wind. Chosen, meant for me, and materialized in the disguising radiance of my room. We have seen the city. It is the gibbous mirror eyes of an insect. All things happen on its balcony and are resumed within. But the action is the cold, syrupy flow of a pageant. One feels too confined, sifting the April sunlight for clues. In the mere stillness of the ease of its parameter, the hand holds no chalk, and each part of the whole falls off and cannot know it knew, except here and there, in cold pockets of remembrance, whispers out of time.